idea, try to get rid of this horrible, horrible idea that moral arbiters such as Mary Whitehouse, who was really, really visible in the tabloid press at the time, that homosexuality was something contagious. I mean, this is, you know, drawing on really homophobic AIDS narratives of the time, and that children have some sense of sort of innate innocence that needs to be protected from this contagion. So he was really sort of starting off this sort of political journey that I think YA has really, really continued.
Mm-hmm. And kind of picking up from that, Simon, when you were writing your books and when you write your next novel, as I'm sure you will, how present is the queer reader, the queer teen, or the queer child in your thought process as you work?
Really present. I mean, partly because that used to be me at that age, and I can't separate myself from that, and I'm always thinking about how reading that sort of book would have affected me when I was, you know, 13, 14, 15, or whatever, had it been around at the time. But also because, I mean, you know, one of the nice things about being an author is that you get to go into schools especially and talk to the young people and the students who are actually reading the book and meet them, and they, you know, and the fact they come up to you afterwards and they will chat to you, and you get to see in real life what sort of effect your work has on them, and that does then translate to when you're writing, because they're in your mind, because you know these kids have come up to you, or they've contacted you on Instagram, or they've emailed you and said what it means, and they're definitely in your mind when you're writing as a result, and I think. I definitely feel a sense of responsibility to them in the way I present what I write, and certainly with Noah, I was really keen to write something that was very very positive and had a happy ending, because at the time I felt that I'd read quite a lot of YA books where gay boys especially would end up dead for some reason. And I was a bit, you know, and it's fine. There's space for stories like that. Of course there is, but I think there needs to be balance. And I was concerned about a lack of fun LGBT YA where people could have a laugh and it wasn't all angsty and doom and gloom. So I was keen to present that sort of angle to those young people who were going through that for sure.
That's excellent. And I mean, obviously, Charlie, as a marketer, you know, you're definitely thinking about the readers and who's going to be buying the books. And I kind of wanted to take a slightly different tack, which is to ask you, you know, what duty do you think, or responsibility do you think that the publishing industry has to serving this readership that's there, whether they are under 18 or over 18, but providing these types of books?
Well, entirely selfishly, I would very much have preferred these books to be available when I was a teen. It would have been something that would have been completely life-changing. So I think my agenda, yes, it's an agenda going into publishing, was always kind of, I want to be able to promote something that I would have loved to have seen as a kid, and for me, that, like, Proud Book is that, so that's kind of a dream come true. But I think also just generally, publishing has a responsibility to reflect teen readers for a YA audience, and if you look at kind of statistics, teen readers are getting more and more gay. Hooray! Well, if you're looking, I mean, readers aren't necessarily the biggest segment of the teenage population, but you've got people who watch media. Oh, is it not? People who watch media, and they've got things like The Bold Type, which is on TV, or Scam, or all sorts.
Is it up?
Can you hear me? Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Things like Sam, or Hayley Kiyoko, or Lauren Draghi, all these people who are suddenly kind of in the pop culture, and if that's happening across other media, why is it not happening in books? So I think publishing's got a real responsibility to look at what is interesting to teenagers. And you just have to look at kind of Tumblr or Twitter or fanfiction in whatever form it is to see that kids want these narratives, and if they're not going to get them from us, they're going to write them themselves. So I think it's clever marketing, and it's clever audience knowledge to cater to teens that want to see themselves in fiction or want to read about their friends. If it's not themselves, then how are you going to have that conversation or get to know somebody's perspective? So for me, it's kind of common sense, and it's something that I think publishing really should be thinking about going forward if they want to expand their market.
A really great point, and I think one of the points that you raised, Charlie, the other day when we were chatting about this event kind of in advance was, you know, about the expectations that readers have today to see themselves in books and in narratives and in television. And I was listening to a podcast called The Decoder Ring, which has a really great episode on John Locke, if anyone's a Sherlock shipper with John Watson. I'm not, but it was a fascinating episode. But it was talking about, you know, the kind of demands that people online on Twitter and Tumblr and different social media channels, you know, for their ships that they support on TV and wanting those ships to be made canon. And those relationships that didn't exist, but, you know, one day hopefully will. And so I think there's different expectations going in to the readers today. And I just can't help but kind of come back to, and I hope we're not belaboring the point, but, like, how much has changed in the last, particularly 15 years, since the repeal of Section 28, I think particularly, and I don't know if everyone knows what Section 28 is, but just to, you know, just to recap for those, it was an amendment that stated that a local authority shall not intentionally promote homosexuality or publish material with the intention of promoting homosexuality or promote the teaching in any maintained school of the acceptability of homosexuality as a pretended family relationship. And all of us would have grown up partially under Section 28, so, and also have seen the changes, so I wondered if you could speak to what you noticed.
Well, I mean, that piece of legislation would have, I think, prevented me from going into schools talking about Noah and standing in front of groups of teenagers and telling them, you know, my personal story. For sure. And I think as well, you know, the legislation was interpreted in various different ways by local authorities and teachers. But I think there's no doubt when I was at school, which was exactly during this time of Section 28, there were no LGBT books in the library. And that is probably why. So one thing that has definitely changed, and I've certainly seen, you know, in the last couple of years when I've been writing, is that now these school libraries are full of LGBT books. They're doing huge pride displays that they proudly advertise on Twitter. A lot of these schools have LGBT student groups. I've been in to speak to some of them. They're supported by the school and by the staff. It's fantastic. Not all schools by any means, and some still have a lot of work to do to get to that place, but that is definitely a change from when I was at school, and that was happening. I think that said, you shouldn't underestimate the legacy that a piece of legislation like that can have on a community and a group of people, and I think it does, and the effect of it, I think, does echo down through the years and still can be felt today. Both in, you know, the fact that some educational professionals are still nervous about this sort of content, about the fact that, you know, a lot of gay teens won't get any sort of LGBT-specific sex education or healthy relationships chats at school as part of sex ed or anything like that. And I think, indeed, in terms of the writers who are writing today, who grew up under this sort of regime and still, you know, there's still issues that come out of being made to feel like you're wrong or dirty when you're growing up at school, and that can't help but influence the how you think and how you live your life and what you end up writing sometimes. And so that it does have an effect even now.
Yeah, I think also you can see in the way that I mean, teachers themselves weren't allowed to come out to their students. It wasn't just kind of the theoretical, it was the very kind of personal as well. They couldn't talk about their personal lives. And I know there's always going to be that slight teacher barrier because that's just common sense, but to not be able to even kind of allude to having a same-sex partner or be transgender, etc., it's just that completely would have been a silencing effect. And like you said, I think you're very right when you say about the authors who are writing now who still kind of have that self-censorship feeling where they go, oh, am I allowed to say that? Or even kind of editors and agents acquiring these books, they're still somewhat affected, kind of even subconsciously. That might not be something as that kind of, oh, that's an adult taboo subject, we can't touch on that. Or even when trying to break it down, there's that kind of how far can we go, what's kind of the acceptable line here, and I think that really does have a ramification on the work that we see, and it's really our responsibility to kind of say that it's okay, just share your story, because somebody out there, their life might be safe by having that mirror out there. So I think it's really important and really amazing that now we're starting, I think, gradually to see a bit of a rapid increase, and I hope it continues, and I'm certainly going to keep pushing and keep banging on about it to hope that it does. So yeah, I think it's an important step to mark in our history when we're thinking about why these books weren't accessible before and why they might be now, and just keep clamouring for more.
I was just to kind of add on to that, I was thinking about, I really became aware of the disparity between what was published in the UK and what was published in the US around 2012, when Hollow Pike was published, Geno Dawson's first novel, and when Hayley Long published What's Up with Jodie Barton. They led an event together, and it was like, the UK has YA books now. They're not imported from America. And it was really exciting. And it was exciting. It was, you know, an exciting time to kind of be talking about these things in, you know, which was 6 years ago. And a couple of years later, Liz Kessler published Read Me Like a Book, which is a great book. And it's a really great take on the teacher-student romance, which, if you've watched any lesbian film, will know that it recurs.
Liz had actually written that book 13 years ago. She put that book away in a drawer because she'd sent it to publishers and they said, oh, we can't do this. Because probably of Section 28, it would have been around that time.
Absolutely.
So it only took her kind of doing the mermaids for a while to be able to have this success to say, well, I've done that and things are changing. Can I actually bring that novel out of the drawer and share it?
Exactly. And it is a great novel, and I do think it's sort of, because it was 13 years older, it does kind of read like an early 20th century, I mean, that's my slant on it, but, you know, like, it's still a great text, but it does have a slight element to that slightly earlier stage. And so it's interesting when you start looking at UK YA authors and the different histories there. And so kind of thinking about what's come and what's coming and everything, I'd like to ask, you know, from your own reading experience or viewing experience, I think, just talking about novels kind of cuts off the channels in which we all consume narratives these days. You know, what are stereotypes or tropes that you all would like to see less of, personally? And what types or identities or representations would you like to see more of?
One that really, I know it has its very important place, and I think it's definitely, it needs to be talked about, but I just really don't want to read another YA book that is all about bullying. I'm so tired of bullying as the central theme and that real struggle, because yes, I think everybody has that experience, but it doesn't need to be the whole dominating force. Queer people have whole lives that don't necessarily revolve around that one person who doesn't get it at school, and I think that is something that I just would love to explore in whatever way that is. I think bullies, and particularly violent episodes of bullying, they can just pull you out of a story that you're otherwise enjoying and be triggering. So to circumnavigate that and do something different and not fall into the obvious trap of having that scene in a book would just be really wonderful.
A couple of things from me. Firstly, more queer narratives where, just the queerness of the characters, of the stories, of whatever's going on, is just a starting point, like Charlie said, for all kinds of other explorations. So why not have someone who is queer and super successful, queer and also an astronaut, queer and also like taking part in some sort of sci-fi or fantasy narrative, but more stories. I think you said this earlier, where queerness is actually incidental to the book, because we've actually come past this point of yes, bullying, and secondly, the sort of, I suppose, over-focus on the coming out story. So coming out narratives are actually important, but actually a lot of people, like a lot of characters, by the time they get to 17, 18, potentially they're really concerned about other things. They've been there, they've been through this, and now they're thinking differently. And then also, there are still far more books about male characters and white male characters. So I think many, many more. books about women, non-binary people, queer and trans, people of colour. I think